Hi, let's talk about the internal features of the heart. The heart, as you know, is a four-chambered organ. There are two atria, which receive blood, and two ventricles, which distribute blood from the heart. The right atrium receives blood from the systemic loop through the superior vena cava and the inferior vena cava, which drain directly into the right atrium. The region in which the vena cavae drain is called the sinus venarum, and it is characterized by its smooth-walled appearance. Now, what we're looking at here is a posterior view of the heart. Here's the diaphragmatic surface there. We can see the left or the pulmonary surface there. The base of the heart is a little out of place. It's been incised and it's pushed up that way, and the wall of the sinus venarum has been reflected to the midline. So looking within the right atrium, we can see a definite contrast between the wall of the sinus venarum and where the pectinate muscles exist. So the myocardium of the atria, as it is organized, comes in these regular bundles or comb-like stretches, like so. That myocardium is going to be surrounded by endocardium, so we're not viewing the myocardium directly, but we can see the evidence of how that myocardium is organized. Now, separating the sinus venarum from the pectinate muscle is the crista terminalis. That crista terminalis is a ridge that is a very sharp defining feature between the sinus venarum to the posterior and the pectinate muscle to the anterior. And it's at the superior portion of this ridge that's just below the epicardium within the myocardium where we can find the SA node. Now, here's another view of the right atrium. This is more from the right border of the heart, but not a perfect right lateral view. We can still see the superior vena cava. We can see how that portion of the inferior vena cava has been reflected away. Here is the right auricle. And what we can see very clearly here is more of the sinus venarum. We can't see any of the pectinate muscle because that will be located up in this region. But what we can see is the interatrial septum. That interatrial septum is the wall between right and left atria. And in the developing heart, in the fetal heart, this is two membranes with a space between them. And that space is called the foramen ovale. If that space persists post-parturition or post-birth, it's referred to as a patent foramen ovale or a PFO. And that's something that we'll see in a subsequent video. We can also see this ridge here, and there's a flap there that is a valve for the coronary sinus. And just adjacent to that is the opening for the coronary sinus. So that is the main conduit for the return of blood from the myocardium into the right atrium. Now, if we travel through the right atrioventricular valve, also known as the tricuspid valve, which is located there, we're within the right ventricle. Now, the tricuspid valve has three cusps. There's an anterior and a posterior and a septal cusp. And those cusps are anchored to extensions of the myocardium called papillary muscles. And the structures which anchor the cusps to the papillary muscles are the chordae tendineae, the tendinous cords. There's an anterior and a posterior and a septal cusp, and what we see is an anterior, which is here, a posterior, and then a septal group of papillary muscles. The chordae tendineae from the different cusps don't have perfect fidelity to the respective papillary muscles. So for instance, the anterior papillary muscle will receive corditendine from both the anterior and the posterior cusps. The septal papillary muscle will receive corditendine from the posterior and the septal cusps. So there isn't a one-to-one correspondence there. Now, the myocardium of the ventricles is much more robust and oriented in different directions than it is within the atria. So the ventricles, during systole, have to propel blood throughout the either entirety of the pulmonary or an even greater feat, systemic loops. And so it's difficult to see for how this is lit, but those large meaty beams of myocardium still enveloped by endocardium are called the trabeculae carnei, or meaty beams for short. One very specialized ridge of myocardium, and it's been cut here, is the septomarginal trabecula. The septomarginal trabecula, or moderator band, cuts across from the interventricular septum, or wall, and if this were in place, we would see how it would move from the septum to that anterior papillary muscle. And it's that septomarginal trabecula which is transporting the right bundle branch across to the right wall of the right ventricle. We can also see somewhat the interventricular septum there. We can see here is that interventricular sulcus and the associated anterior interventricular artery and great cardiac vein within the sulcus. And so we can see the relationship between that sulcus and the septum. Finally, if we follow the path of blood, so it will move through the atrioventricular valve thusly, and then when the ventricles contract during systole, that blood is pumped superiorly towards the pulmonary valve, which feeds into the pulmonary trunk. If we look, that region of the ventricle really lacks the characteristic trabecula carnei of the rest of the ventricle. It's very smooth walled, and this area is called the infundibulum. And so that blood from the infundibulum passes through the pulmonary valve into the pulmonary trunk, which divides into the pulmonary arteries, which then serve to transport blood to the right and left lungs, respectively. And then that blood is returned back to the left atrium via pulmonary veins. And we can see on the right side, so here we're looking at a posterior view of the heart where the base has been incised and the wall of the left atrium has been reflected away. Here are two pulmonary veins. We're going to have two on either side. There's another pulmonary vein. There would be another pulmonary vein. So four pulmonary veins in total. We can't see the interatrial septum here, but as it's a division between right and left atria, we can necessarily know that it would exist. We can get a very good view of the atrioventricular valve that separates the left atrium from the left ventricle, which is called the bicuspid or the mitral valve. And we can see some of the pectinate muscle within the wall of the auricle there. But we can still see how it has this very smooth walled appearance posteriorly, much like the right atrium. So as we enter into the left ventricle through the bicuspid valve, we can see the corditendine attaching to an anterior and a posterior papillary muscle. We have a better view of those trabecula carnei there. We also have a very good view of the interventricular septum. And we don't have a particularly good view of the aortic valve, but it's going to sit approximately there. And I can tell that because I can see the origin of the left coronary artery there. So there's the anterior interventricular artery, and then there we've got the circumflex running underneath the left auricle there. And so the left aortic sinus of Valsalva is approximately that. So the aortic valve will sit below it. So we can kind of see the ascending aorta there. And we have a good view of the pulmonary trunk and the pulmonary valve within with its three cusps that are all brought into approximation. So those are the features of the internal heart. As you think about these, I would think about the commonalities of features between right and left atria, right and left ventricles, and then think about the commonalities of features between the atria and the ventricles, such as, you know, the fact that there are these ridges of muscles in the atria. They exist as pectinate muscles. In the ventricles, they exist as trabecula carni. There are septa that separate a particular chamber from its contralateral partner. These are some of the things which will enable you to understand the structure as well as the function of the heart. Thank you very much for your time.